A low-frequency oscillator generates a signal that cycles through a relatively slow pattern. Although it's used in two different ways, as modulation and effects for Renoise and Redux, the core method of constructing the LFO is identical in both. The LFO device, found in the sampler's modulation section, is used to affect the audio directly. Of particular note is that in the volume domain, it creates tremolo. And in the pitch domain, vibrato. The mode buttons select the generated shape from sine, sawtooth, pulse or square, as well as a random oscillator. The frequency parameter controls the speed of the oscillation. While amplitude sets the maximum range that the value will oscillate to. D-phase changes which part of the oscillation cycle that the signal will start at. This has no effect in random mode. And delay is the amount of time at the start of the modulation that the LFO cycle will be delayed by. Essential if you'd like to begin with something different before running the LFO. If you're unfamiliar with the modulation section of the sampler, then you should know that multiple devices can be chained together in various ways to create a more complex, lively movement. And, of all the device types, this is most relevant to the LFO, disabling this button will change the frequency value from strictly time-based to beat-synced. Incredibly useful if you want modulations to synchronize with the music. And they keep pace with any BPM changes. As an effect, the LFO is a meta device used for creating parameter modulations. The oscillation is still constructed using amplitude, frequency, and signal shapes, but this device has some important changes and additions to take a look at. Dest sets the destination track or sampler effects chain, the chosen effect, and the parameter. Amplitude functions in the same way as before, setting the maximum range of the oscillation, while offset can offset the central point of the modulation to a different position. You can see the effect these values are having by looking at the meters here. The left is the original signal, and the right is the signal being sent to the destination after being affected by the amplitude and offset. Frequency controls the speed of the oscillation, but here, the value is measured in lines per cycle. This makes it easy to match the cycle length to what's happening in the pattern editor. And it also means the speed will respond to changes in both the BPM and the song's LPB. The four standard shapes are the same as before, accompanied by another custom option, which introduces even more controls for crafting a customized signal. The main graphical section displays the envelope and the points used to create it. The length parameter sets the number of lines that make up the envelope in a range from 1 to 1024. A handy tip here is that setting this to match the frequency value will make each line of the grid equal to one line in the pattern editor. Customizing a signal works just like the graphical automation panel used for track effects, so we won't go over all of the controls, but here's a quick rundown of the most useful ones. Left-click dragging a point will move it around. Holding down left control will display the current value of a point and also lock it in place horizontally when you move it, allowing you to fine-tune its value vertically. Double-clicking on an empty line will create a new point, while double-clicking on an existing point will remove it. For even more editing options in a larger workspace, hit this button to open the external editor. There's also the usual interpolation modes, a bank of presets for storing and recalling envelopes, and the one-shot toggle that, when enabled, will run the envelope only once, until a reset command is given. As you'll have seen from the envelope graph and the meters, the modulation runs constantly, even while the song is stopped. So, to synchronize the modulation cycle to the song's playback, which will ensure it runs the same way each time, you have to automate the reset button. This is achieved by right-clicking on it, which places a command in the track's Master Effects column, and can be done while the song is stopped or playing. You can also control the position of the reset by manually entering the effect command X8YY, where X stands for the location of the device in the effect chain, 1 if it's the first device, 2 if it's the second, etc., and YY is the offset value. As always, effect command values are hexadecimal. So, for example, if YY is equal to 00, then the modulation restarts from the beginning. At 40, it restarts from a quarter of the way through the cycle. 80 will be halfway, C0 three quarters, and FF will restart from just before the end. If you're unfamiliar with these concepts, then check out our YouTube channel, which has videos explaining both hexadecimal and effect commands. Syncing modulation has been demonstrated here with track effects. It is possible to do the same with sample effects, though you have to set this up by using macros. So again, if you need help with this, check out our previous video on the subject. Chaining devices in the sampler's modulation section is easy, since it happens automatically as they're placed. But it's also possible to do this for LFO effects. The simplest method is to set up an LFO as normal, but then control its parameters. However, to craft a more complex oscillation by combining different signals, you'll need to make use of another device, the Metamixer.